Okay, welcome to the first episode of 2021 of the Wasting Time Podcast. I'm one of your hosts, Chris. I'm on the line with Nick as ever. How's it going, Nick? You good?
I'm good, man. Happy New Year.
Happy New Year to you.
And we're joined by Jay today as well. Happy New Year, Jay.
Happy New Year.
When do we run? When is the cutoff for stopping wishing people Happy New Year? I feel like we're...
I wanted to call it yesterday. I don't know, but well,
sorry,
I'll do
I extended
you.
It.
Yeah.
I think 1 week is reasonable. I think we're pushing it slightly doing today, but anything after today is really pushing it.
So where are you joining from? Joining us from today?
I live just north of Boston. So I've been out here. I'm from Seattle originally, and I lived in LA when I was a kid. But I've been out in Boston. 30 years now. So it's home. It's cold, but this part I don't like. I love it here, except right now it's so cold.
Yeah, you get some brutal winters there, presumably.
Yeah. I'm actually taking off like at the end of this month. I'm such a baby about the cold. We're taking off. We're going to Austin, Texas. We're just going to spend a few weeks there because I just hate it so much.
Okay. Yeah. I was going to say that would be in the build up to South by Southwest, but obviously not.
Typically,
right now.
Not this time.
Yeah.
But that is how I got to know Austin so well. I was playing South by so much.
Oh, okay.
And, and then just being on tour in general. We played, I think it was called the Fun 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 Fest down there. And I don't know. It's a great music city. It's just, it's a cool city in general. So it's like the only place in Texas I would go.
Okay.
But it's cool.
I guess on that show, I mean, is it worth just kind of going through a bit of your kind of journey through music, kind of what you've done, how you started, obviously your experience with bands and now your work,
sure.
Production and engineering. I guess, take us back a bit to the start in terms of, your introduction to music and, influences when you were young and how it all started.
Totally. I mean, I guess like where it like really started for me was we have something called middle school here. I don't know if you guys have middle school, but it's basically sixth grade. And that's right when I was in sixth grade in 1991. Nirvana Nevermind came out that year and that was it, right? Like I was 11 and that was the best thing I'd ever heard. Mm-hmm. So it got me excited about rock music for the first time. But 11, 12 years old is like a really formative age when it comes to starting to develop just like the concept of like your identity through different artistic modes of expression. So music was like totally a catalyst for me in that way. And so I wanted a guitar. So for Christmas, I think it took me until Christmas 1992. I wanted an electric guitar. I got an acoustic guitar. But my parents seemed to think that learning on acoustic would be a better idea for me to do first. I think they were probably right. Not that I agreed with them.
Better idea for them, I guess.
Better idea for them particularly. Right. That's a good point. That's probably actually what was going on.
I wanted to play drums when I was a kid and I ended up with a guitar. So
totally. Yeah. And so I started taking private lessons right away. And then I really loved it, but I didn't take it really seriously until I was like 14, air quotes really seriously, but until I was 14, other kids that I went to school with, I went to a really, really small school. So like my graduating class was 39 kids. It's just like not that many to choose from. Right. But a few of us were like, dude, like we should make a band too. So I was into skateboarding like since I was like five or something. Like I'm wearing a Pal Peralta hoodie right now, right? So like and so for that reason, that crossover with punk rock and skateboarding was like always like a really like really entrenched. So for me it was a really natural transition to start listening to like Husker Du, Minor Threat, all of these like older punk bands. They were older than me, but they were cool to me because it was like I was always the young skater, so it was what like the kids at the park were listening to. Mm-hmm. And I looked up to them because they're older and better at skating than me. And in my mind, I was going to be like a professional skater one day. That did not happen. But so like I liked that. So naturally, when I started playing music, like I just wanted to play punk rock. And so that's what we did. So that was like the intro. Fast forward a few years, a bunch of really shitty bands later. Like I was going to summer school because I favored going to the skate park more than I did English class. And I was at summer school and there was a kid there. he had like, I don't know if you guys remember how old you guys are, but like at the time he had like the hemp necklace with like the beads in it. It was like he had three X's in the beads. Right. And so I walked up to him and I was like, hey, like, are you straight edge? You know? And he's like, yeah, are you straight edge? I was like, yeah. And then he's like, do you like Candiria? And I was like, and to be honest, I had no fucking idea who Candiria was. But of course I went, yeah. And so, and he's like, cool, like you should come to my band practice. And so I did. I was like 17, had a car, and I was like, yeah, cool, I'll come by. And so, like I said, my school was really, really small. So I was big fish in the world's smallest pond. And I met these guys, and they lived in a bigger city. And dude, like they were so much better than me. And I just wanted to hang out with these guys. So I was like, holy, like you guys are so good. So I was really impressed. So I just became like a barnacle to them. I just like stuck around like, wow, like I want to, what I'm doing in my town is horrible comparatively. So I ended up getting asked to join that band. And that was my first tour, like right when I graduated high school. They asked me to join because their guitar player is being a flake. And I was like, yeah. And they're like, cool, we're going on tour in a couple of weeks. And I was like, all right. And I didn't know, dude, we toured in a minivan. I remember I asked, I was like, should I bring like money and stuff, you know? and they're like, oh yeah, yep, you're going to want that.
If you want to eat, I would advise totally. Bringing some money.
Yeah, I didn't know, dude, I had no idea. I was like, so are there going to be like 1,000 people at the, what are we doing, you know?
Yeah.
And so I was so green. Maybe coming from a small town was good. Cause I just didn't know, but I was like, yeah, sure. And I remember we shortly after that, we toured Canada. I forgot to tell my mom. She had already left for work and I hadn't moved out yet. Like that's how young I was.
Yeah.
And
well, you still like 17 at this point.
Yeah, totally.
Yeah.
And I remember I just left a note on the counter and it just said, mom, went to Canada. If there's an emergency, call Canada, see you in a couple weeks. And yes, and then I went out. She's obviously super pissed. I think she might still have that little piece of paper though. It's funny now.
Looking back for sure.
Yeah, totally. And just through a graduation of like being in bands, touring and networking, I was in a band that no one knows about called Pictures of Gabriel. That was the first band signed to Deathwish Records, but we were just young and we just didn't, we couldn't hold it together. So we broke up before our release came out. And so I think Deathwish hit me up like earlier this year and asked me if they maybe want to do like a digital release of that. Cause that was supposed to be the first thing on Deathwish that wasn't Converge or Boy Sets Fire because Trey, there's two owners of Deathwish, there's Jake and Trey, and Trey was the tour manager for Boy Sets Fire. And Jake is obviously in Converge. Mm-hmm. So like those were the first releases, but aside from those releases, we were going to be like, I don't know, the first one, and we totally screwed it up. So, and then I spent like another like 7 years thinking that, because I was like 19 when that happened, thinking like, oh, this is just how it goes. I make a band and I get signed and like everyone loves me and it'll be awesome. Yeah. And it's like totally not how it goes. And so I started Defeater when I was like 27, 28. And then I had all the experience of like getting kicked around and not meeting the expectations that I had thought I was going to meet. By the time Defeater got some traction and we started touring like pretty regularly, I knew to cherish it like way more and how to nurture it way better because I wasn't 19 like anymore.
How quickly did the kind of signing to Bridge Nine happen after
Defeater? It's pretty quick.
Okay,
so well, here's what happened. So right before Defeater, my friend Andy, who was the original drummer of Defeater and he plays in Death of a Nation with me now, he and I were seeing like we were playing in like, because I've always liked bands like At the Drive-In, Mars Volta, Sparta, like that world. And so we were playing like some weird polyrhythmic melodic bullshit, right? And I saw all my friends' hardcore bands in Boston. Hardcore is such a big deal at that time. So I was like, no offense, like we are so much better musicians than these people, you know? And I was like, we should start a hardcore band. Let's make it a joke. And so we did. We thought we'd last like 6 months. We let my roommate name it. And I was like, yeah, name it anything you want. And he's like, name it Sluts. And so we were like, Sluts? And so we're like, all right, well, we said you can name it whatever you want. And so we literally, so Sluts, the band, You find it on Spotify. we decided, we got this crazy idea that we were going to follow Warp Tour around. And we were going to plan a tour basically around like where Warp Tour went. But okay. We were going to get to Warp Tour every morning, 6, 7 a.m. And we were going to break in every day. And we were going to sell like CDs to people at Warp Tour. Like, and it was crazy, dude. Like the first, I had to break into Tiger Stadium in Detroit. And I literally didn't know what to do. It was the first time we ever tried this.
Yeah.
I had like fucking security guards and stuff. And I was like, what am I going to do?
Yeah.
So I, literally out of a sitcom, I grabbed I saw a bunch of people bringing like boxes of oranges in.
Mm-hmm.
Well, of course, they're in uniform. I'm not. Right. And I just got right behind the last guy. I grabbed a box of oranges. I put my CDs under the box. And I just hugged like the back of that guy as he walked in, and the security guard was like, yeah, you guys are the oranges guys. Cool. And then I just like went in, and then I was like, I cannot believe that just worked. And
that is hustling for you,
dude. Right. And then, so I saw a porta potty, and I was like, sweet. I went into the porta potty. I just sat in there for like an hour and a half looking through the little perforations, waiting for it to like fill in, because you're supposed to have a wristband, and like all this stuff. I just like had to wait for it to fill in more so I could kind of mix in. And anyway, we were doing that
with
every day.
With your 500 oranges in hand.
Yeah, oh, I put the oranges down. Yeah, put the oranges next to the porta potty, maybe someone grabbed them. But so we were doing that, and there was a label there called Top Shelf Records. They're actually out of Massachusetts.
Oh, yeah,
too. Yeah, we had some loose connection, like the Top Shelf dudes sort of knew who we were and vice versa. And so we would ask Top Shelf, like, hey, can we hide our boxes of CDs like just under your table, and we'll go out, we'll hustle, whatever. And they're like, yeah, it's fine. And then, you know, a couple of days in, they're like, what are you guys doing exactly? And we're like, well, we booked a tour around Warped Tour. We're not playing Warped Tour. We're definitely not supposed to be here. We're breaking in every day. We're trying to find used wristbands so we can collect all the colors, so we look like we're supposed to. We could have gone to Staples and bought wristbands. You know what I mean? It's like ridiculous. But in the meantime, it was like Mission Impossible. I'm trying to steal people's bracelets so we can be at Warped Tour. And so they're like, that's crazy. So when it came and they saw us hustling records, they just saw us working really hard. Oh, the other thing we did that was like made the whole thing profitable. This is very not like 2021 acceptable anymore, but we made stickers, vinyl stickers that say "I heart sluts." That is the perfect thing to sell at Warped Tour. Like, right. You just walk around with those, and biker moms and weird dudes are just like, "Yo, let me get a sticker." And so we're just crushing. Each sticker's a buck, right? So right. We sold like 10,000 stickers.
Oh wow!
On the tour, and so like we were living good, you know, and so we're crushing it with the stickers, we're pushing our music, and then we'd have to take off every day like 3, 4 p.m. because we, you know, our show would be a couple of hours outside of whatever Warped Tour date that was.
Mm-hmm.
So we go play the show. Well, the problem with Warped Tour is it's really meant as a bus tour. So like they expect that you'll play Warped Tour, you'll get on your bus, have a couple beers, get in your bunk, and then your driver who's been sleeping all day will drive you to the next one. You wake up, rinse and repeat. Well, it's not really how it works when you're a bunch of scrappy punk kids in a van. You just were at Warped Tour at 6 a.m. You broke in. You hustled all day. You drove 2 hours. You played a show. Well, the next Warped Tour is 9 hours away.
Oh, God. Right?
Yeah. So you're like, oh, all right, who's taking first shift? And just like Red Bull and coffee and just do it again. So anyway, Top Shelf Records was just like, you guys are out of your goddamn mind. And we want to put out your next record because you're just working so hard.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
And so we're like, cool. So then, so the original Defeater record, Travels, was written by Andy Reitz, who I just mentioned earlier, and myself. And our singer at the time wasn't having a good go of getting the vocals done. He was really frustrated. He was also going just through some stuff like personally. And I remember we were hanging out trying to get the record done. And he was like, someone was like, oh, that's so spontaneous. And he goes, yeah, just like when I bought my ticket to Hawaii. And I was like, what ticket to Hawaii? You're going to Hawaii? He's like, yeah, Thursday. And I was like, this Thursday. Yeah. And he's like, yeah. I was like, are you coming back? He's like, I don't think so.
Oh.
I was like, why are we recording vocals? And so now I had this record. That was Mike. Mike took off. And now I had this record that was basically done. Like I mostly mixed it and it was done. We were just trying to get vocals on it and I had to hunt around. And I bumped into a dude at a record store in New Hampshire, not too far from here. And we started talking. That ended up being the singer Defeater. I asked him to come down. We tried out a few people, but that was the fit. And then from there, we were just like, all right, here we go. Like the record was done. And so I talked to Top Shelf and I said, hey, like, we're probably gonna change the name. No offense. Like our band being called Sluts really isn't our favorite thing. And
not particularly marketable either, really, probably from a label perspective.
No, yeah, exactly. No great bands are gonna be like, you know who should we bring out as our 2 of 4 on the support tour? Sluts. Yeah, it's just like not gonna happen. So yeah, we changed the name, kind of changed the aesthetic. But so that record, the first record, Travels, was written as though like it was gonna be the second Sluts LP. But we just sort of like we're like, well, change plans. Yeah, and then from there, dude. Bridge Nine, Death Wish, and Century Media hit me up all within like the same week. We were getting some traction and doing some stuff. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I remember Carl, who's now at Epitaph, actually down the road, fast forward, would be part of the reason we signed to Epitaph. But Carl, who was the label manager at Bridge Nine at the time, called me. Cause I was recording a lot of records for Bridge Nine at the time. Right. So I was recording, Dead Swans and I can't remember, but a verse and all this stuff. So, yeah.
So your that career kind of started in between, I guess your early bands and your later bands then.
Yeah, right? Totally. Like I'd been recording for a while, like back when no one liked my band, I was already recording and then I was actually already recording full time. So here in Boston, I was doing a ton of work. So I started doing work for the local labels, some of which are the hardcore labels, so like Deathwish and like Bridge Nine.
Right, okay.
And so when my band started like to get some traction, it was kind of an easy conversation to have with Chris Wren, who owns Bridge Nine, about licensing the vinyl version of Defeater Travels. So that was like our gateway onto Bridge Nine. But we just worked our asses off, dude. And so because I was already recording records in Boston for Bridge Nine, Deathwish, whatever, it was a pretty easy conversation and easy transition. Next thing you know, they're licensing the vinyl version of Travels. After that, we put out Lost Ground, and that's like really where like we got some traction.
So when did you end up over here then? When did I assume it's with Defeater, your first introduction to the UK from a touring perspective?
It was. What was it? Oh yeah, Carl, who signed us to Bridge Nine, called me and he just said, hey, Polar Bear Club and Ruiner need an opener. A horrible financial mistake in the short term,
right?
But it ended up being way worth it because we got our feet wet when it came to international touring on that tour. So we got paid $75 a night for a full like UK run for a couple weeks, but it was fine. But that was like in June, so the UK is like super nice in June, and I just remember being like, wow, this place is like magical. I love this.
Yeah, you've certainly got the best of the weather over here in June. If you came now, you probably wouldn't be as mind you, you're probably well seasoned to it.
Yeah, I've also done tours in December in the UK, and that's not nearly as fun.
I was just gonna say, any particular favorite stop-offs when you've been over here?
Well, for us, like, you hear about London your whole life, probably no matter where you live. So
right,
that was pretty amazing. And so we played the Underworld. That was probably one of the better shows of the tour. Mm-hmm. We did play some academies and stuff on that, but yeah, I think we did that early in the tour. So for me, it was just insane. Like I'm getting off of a plane. I'm in London because I wrote punk songs with my friends. And
that's pretty mad, isn't it?
Dude, and I didn't know anything. So I didn't have like the adapters. Like I wanted to charge my BlackBerry. That really dates it. My BlackBerry at the time I wanted to charge. And you guys got all those big ass wall plugs. So I just assumed the entire world had the exact same plug. So right. I was like, yeah, I'll bring my charger. Cool. I didn't understand there's like a completely different power standard, like depending on where you are. And that it changes when you go to mainland Europe, and then it changes when you're in Switzerland, and then it changes when you're in Australia. I didn't know any of that stuff. So yeah, my first purchase in England, I want to say our first show was in Bristol. And I just remember walking down the street, like with my charger, like I need to figure this out. And so I was just going into shops that looked like they might have anything that could help me, basically mm-hmm. equivalent of like an American Radio Shack or something. And I went in and I fucking couldn't believe it. I found one. I felt like I had just discovered like treasure. I was like, I can charge my phone now. yeah, so that was cool. The weather was great. Shows were awesome. I was kind of a psycho on that tour. I was like going through a breakup. So it was just like a whole mess of mm-hmm. like, so I landed in, I think, London, and I just got a text from my girlfriend who was, talk about like, don't shit where you eat, who worked for Bridge Nine. My girlfriend at the time worked for Bridge Nine. She was a PR person. And I landed, and when I landed, she just said, she's done. And I was like, oh, cool. And so I'm like, you know, like you're like deplaning, you're like in that little row and everyone's like grabbing their bags out of the overhead compartment and stuff. And I'm like, okay. And I'm like doing that. And I'm looking at my phone. Everyone's like, are you okay? I was like, I just got dumped. Right. And so it was just like, it was a really surreal experience. And a guy named by the name of Paul Catton drove us on that tour. And so Paul picked us up, and I remember he just looked at me, and I was just being weird because I just got dumped, and he was trying to be all jovial and cool with everybody, and everyone's trying to have a good time, but all the dudes know that I'm like super bummed out.
Yeah,
totally. Yeah, but hey, it was worth it. Whatever.
So I guess Epitaph came along a little bit later in the Defeater journey, yeah. Right? I mean, that must have been pretty big deal for you at the time, right?
Yeah, dude, it was. Well, we put out Empty Days and Sleepless Nights a couple records later. That was the biggest record Defeater ever did, probably ever will do. Mm-hmm. I remember Carl, I was at dinner. Once again, Carl keeps rearing his head into these stories. We had already moved over to Epitaph, and he said, hey, can I sign you guys yet or what? And I said, actually, you can't, Carl, because when you were at Bridge Nine, you signed us to a 3 LP deal. So I got to do another one here first. So it was interesting because I knew there was interest from Epitaph before I even wrote the last record for Bridge Nine, you know? And so I was like, and we just put this out, you know, we're going to do a 2 or 3 year cycle mm-hmm. on this record before I put out the next one. And then there's going to be a couple years before we put out the next one. So it was like, I could almost see Epitaph as a possibility, but it was like a 5 year thing. I just knew it was going to be way down the road. And then when we, the band kept growing, put out Letters Home on Bridge Nine, and that's, we were actually playing Warped Tour. I wasn't just breaking in and hiding in porta potties.
Okay. Yeah. Nice change. Yeah.
Yeah. We were actually playing Warped Tour, and, I got a call from our manager, and he's like, hey, I was like, what's up? He's like, Brett Gurewitz wants to sign your band. When can you do a phone call? And I was like, any fucking time Brett Gurewitz wants.
Huge.
And yeah, dude, I was outside of a Waffle House in, I think, St. Louis or Memphis. And that was when it was scheduled. And I was just like, all right. And it went down just like that. Phone rang. I was like, oh, it's a California number. And I was like, hello. He's like, hey, what's up, man? Is this Jay? I go, yeah, what's up? He goes, hey, this is Brett. Yo, I really like your band. I want to sign your band. That's how it worked. And I was like, okay. And I said, well, we're really big fans of the label, dude. And so I think this would be a good home for us, be a good fit. That's what happened. And the thing that was interesting about it was that we had a suspicion because Felicia, who I think still works at Epitaph, was just randomly, speaking of Texas, was just like randomly at one of our shows in Texas. And I was like, what are you doing here? You live in Silver Lake, California. And she's like, and she kind of gave me this look like, I think you know what I'm doing here. And I was like, ah, sick. And then shortly after, everything happened. But then the lawyers duked it out. Like, Brett was real cool, man. Like, you know, there were some things about the deal that our lawyer was like, nope. And I was like, yo, I'm trying to sign an Epitaph, dude. Like, can we just say yes, right? And he's like, I remember his words were, I'm a deal maker, not a deal breaker, baby. And I was like, I fucking hope so, dude. And, but yeah, he had all the stuff worked out, and we got a great contract out of it. It was awesome. And yeah, signed Epitaph. Got to put out a record on, like, it blows my mind because I was like, whatever, 14 years old buying Offspring Smash, right? And then now, like, that little logo's on the back of my record. It's pretty crazy.
But was it not long after that that you kind of took a step back from DeVito.
Yeah, actually, it's true.
Yeah.
I have a story for that as well. So we were in Germany, and I just like, so tour's tough. I've been touring, as you know, since the moment I got out of high school. Mm-hmm. The other thing that tour does, just like I got dumped on the plane in London, tour is like, when you're touring a lot, it's really, really hard on your social relationships. You're just never around, right? So you've got like your tour family, and then like you come home and you're like, I'm making records. So I'm like really busy in the studio, and you only have so much time, you know? And I was married, and like, dude, my first wife just had enough. She just, right. Okay. So, and I found out about that, literally like flew to Australia. She was kind of being weird. And then it was just a couple days later, I was at a rest stop. I'm just like one to call shit out. So I was like, hey, you're being fucking weird, you know? And yeah, she's like, well, I don't know how I feel. And I was like divorce, you don't know how you feel? And she's like, I'm not sure. I'm like, I'm not sure is a yes. Yeah, totally.
It must be hard as well. I mean, in those situations, if you're around, you've got the opportunity to just kind of flesh it out and figure it out. But when you're on the other side of the fucking world, right? It's
totally. That was 2 days into like a 2 month long tour. So we were doing on that tour, we were doing Australia, UK. We played Download Fest on that tour.
Okay.
All of mainland Europe, Russia, the Middle East, right? So it was like kind of a half world tour type thing. Mm-hmm. And so I think she just used that as a moment to like, that was a moment where for her not being into confrontation, she could sort of just like, she had 2 months to just get her shit and whatever. So it was crazy. Like I remember just being on that tour, being in Germany and looking around and seeing like, I was in the same like catering line as Davey Havoc and Judas Priest and Pennywise. And like, you know, I don't know, to be fair, my life was like really upside down at that point because like, you know, going through divorce sucks, especially because I remember I told her, I was like, hey, let me just come home. You know, like, let me just come home. We'll get a fill in, like we'll figure this out. And she was like, you know, I really don't want you to come home. So it's like, oh, all right, cool. So I'm just going to sit here on tour and rot. You know? Mm-hmm. And, yeah, it was rough, dude. And so I was just looking around and I kind of realized that, you know, dreams and stuff, like everything I wanted to do, within that capacity, kind of done, you know, like Download Festival's really big. Like we played Gros Rock in Belgium and I played Australia. I was in Moscow. Like, yeah, you know, it's like we were doing this and it was cool. And I think I was never in love with touring in the first place. It was just sort of the thing you do to grow your art. But I was like really in love with making art, you know? So I realized I could, you know, it's interesting to get to that point and get that perspective, because if you're not the right person for that, like you can look at that catering line and you can say, if I keep doing this, like I'm going to be in the equivalent to this catering line. That's it. This is it. You show up, maybe like my band plays a little later in the day. You know what I mean? Like maybe, mm-hmm. But I understand. I get on the plane. We got the back line. We bring the merch. We make the records. I'm at the festival. Like I totally get it. And there was just this like, weird moment of clarity where I'm getting my like fucking sloppy chicken out of the catering line, you know? And I'm just like, right, this is what this is. And it's really cool. And I worked really, really hard to get here.
Yeah.
But my, I don't know what you call it, like my mood or like my, just the way I looked at it changed. And I think that was pretty easily reflected like externally too. I think people could kind of tell like the shine of the dream had worn off for me just a little bit.
Okay.
And so that, you know, and the other guys were like, they were like gung ho still. And I was kind of like, let's slow down. The other thing too, I was being really honest about like the trajectory and the arc of the band. You know, I look at the numbers, I look at the shows and all that stuff. And, you know, we signed Epitaph and we were supposed to do like some ridiculous number of first week sales. Well, we did a fifth of the sales on Epitaph that we did on our last record on Bridge 9.
Oh, wow.
So, okay. That was really telling to me. And I had a really honest conversation. I remember walking around Denver it's funny how I have all these places like stuck in my mind from this conversation. So I was just walking around Denver with a coffee, and again, my manager calls me. He goes, "Yeah, we got the first week, you know, numbers in," and we talked about it. And I was like, "Dude, to me, this is, those numbers don't reflect a why the fuck are we touring full time? It just doesn't like it doesn't reflect like something that's worth touring full time on. Like, I'm really excited that we made the art. I'm really proud of that. But like, he's like, well, you know, that's a consideration. But I, you know, I, for what it's worth, I felt like at the time, by the end, we were touring full time because it paid money and I had other avenues to make money. And it, so like, that wasn't an incentivizer for me anymore. So we just like that, and that put me in a different position, like with the rest of the guys, where it's just like, I don't want to hold you back. But like, I'm not trying to be on the road fucking 6 months, dude. I already like I don't love it. I already like lost a wife, you know. Like, yeah. It's a lot, you know. Yeah. So, there's that line like, dreams cost money, but money costs dreams, you know. Mm-hmm. And it's like that. The balance between that is really hard to walk.
And I guess once you made that decision, did you kind of settle straight back into, yeah, I guess this, I guess the life you have now, is it a journey straight into?
Sort of, yeah. Like, I mean, it was crazy. Like, so I find out that, like, you know, I'm going to be getting a divorce. And very shortly after that, I'm fucking wasted in Sydney, Australia at a pizza place. And I just asked this pretty girl to dance. I actually cut in. She was dancing with my drummer. And I just said, nah, I'm going to dance with this girl. Anyway, that's my wife now.
Oh, and, nice. Nice.
Yeah. Yeah. So I just asked a pretty girl to dance, dude. And
so,
she's
Australian.
Yeah, my wife's from Sydney. Yeah. and she, yeah, dude, we just fell in love super quick. And it was really complicated because, you know, I wasn't being public about like what was going on with my marriage, but like the dudes could obviously see like, why is Jay talking to this girl so much? Right. And, so that was tough. And, it was just weird, but Jessie, my wife, was like really great. I told her, I was like, I got to figure out what's going on, like with my marriage and all that stuff before we can like get too deep here. It was tough because like you can't control feelings, you know? So like you feel a certain way. So it's really exciting. Like you're really compelled to like, you talk all day long every day, you know, I'm sure being super annoying to like everybody else because like you're just obsessed. Like you just like found this person that you just want to talk to all the time. And so yeah. So like when the band and I separated, I just made sense to go into full-time producing. And then I just asked Jessie, you know, I was like, oh, she was already here for a 3-week stint to like come see me. Mm-hmm. I flew her over. This was the second time I had flown her to the States. And, yeah, dude. And I realized I'm not in a band anymore. And so I just said like, do you want to never go home? You know? Mm-hmm. And she was like, I would love to never go home. You know, well, at least we'll go back there for vacations. So, we went, this is such a funny thing. We went to a lawyer because I was like, well, I don't know how any of this works because I think it's illegal for you to just be here forever. So we should probably figure out how this works.
Yeah.
So we got an immigration attorney and we're sitting in the office in downtown Boston. And she's like, well, you can go this way. There's like a work one. There's a fiance one. But if you do the fiance one, you got to do the marriage one anyway. But really the easiest one's the marriage one. And you know, it's really up to you guys. And I remember I said, well, we should probably do the marriage one. And she's like, okay, cool. And I didn't even think about how completely ridiculous that was. Right.
How long were you at that point?
Just a few months, nothing. Yeah. Yeah. A few months. And so we're like, cool. And we decided we were like going to go get some food after that. So we were out on the sidewalk. Jessie loves telling this story. And she's like, so the definition of like being engaged is like intent to marry, right? I was like, yeah, I guess so. Yeah, right. And she's like, and you just told the lawyer that we're going to get like a marriage visa. I was like, yeah. And she's like, so I'm like, oh, fuck, right. So we're engaged. And so it was really, dude, it's like the worst proposal ever. A year or two later, I made it up to her because I realized it was like the absolute worst proposal of all time. and I did a really romantic proposal and surprised her with a new proposal, like in front of nice. Like all her friends and family, like later. Yeah. But yeah, like, yeah. And so we just went to lunch, and she's like, can I like tell people? And mind you, this is so fucked up. I had finalized my divorce. Like, I went to court, did the thing 2 days before that.
Wow.
But I know I didn't. Yeah, I didn't know that I was going to. I just went to the meeting to figure out what was going on. Like, what are the laws? Like, what do I need? What do I need to know? Yeah. And then so technically speaking, I was I was single for 2 days. You know?
It's funny how life works out sometimes. Eh?
Yeah, it really is. Man. Yeah.
I mean, and you are happily married still with kids? Oh, yeah. Right?
Is it just one kid you have? Sorry.
Yeah, we got Dean, little rugrat. He's the best dude. Yeah. So yeah, we shit. I mean, dude, if you could tell me, so like, I left for that tour May 20th or May 25th of 2015. Yeah. Well, dude, I mean, within less than a year, I was not in Defeater anymore. I was not married to that person anymore. I was married within that year to someone I met in Australia, and we were having a kid. And I was just, what a year. You know?
That's crazy.
So of course, all my friends are just like, are you okay? I was like, yeah, I'm okay. This is fucked up. It's crazy, but I'm okay. Yeah.
So let's chat about, I guess, your more recent production career then. So I guess we can start with what have been your best projects today, and what have you most, well, and I guess what you're working on now we can move on to.
Totally. So I've done a lot of stuff. Like right at the end of Defeater, I did like that last Bane record that went well. But
yeah,
I'll be honest, there's a record by a band who I think if they tour and stuff, it's going to blow up. It's a band called Kali Masi. They're from Chicago. And just check it out. They just put out, I did an LP for them, I want to say 2016. But then they flew out. I did that one in Chicago at Atlas Studios, where they recorded Alkaline Trio and shit. And then they came to Boston to my studio here last year around this time. I think we started in February last year. And so they have a single out called The Stray from what's going to be their upcoming new release. It's ridiculous. It's a very, very good record. And the band is full of the sweetest people and hyper talented. So I'm hoping, speaking of Brett, when they put out their last record, my phone rang. I had gotten a new phone. It was really funny. And I was like, hello. And I get this call, and it's, hey Jay, what's up, man? And I was like, who's this? And I just hear him chuckle. He goes, it's Brett Gerwitz. And I was like, Brett, what's up, dude? And he's like, hey, talk to me about this Kali Masi band. And I was like, you should sign them. They're fucking awesome. It didn't end up happening. But they, regardless, you know, they're of the caliber, you know, it's not often that my phone randomly rings and Brett wants to know, right? He's like, this came across my desk. This fucking rules. Tell me about it. Mm-hmm. So I would put that out there. Like, definitely listen to that record when it comes out. Listen to the single now. It's super good.
You've been doing a lot of stuff with Rebuilder recently, I see. Like they yeah. they seem to be getting a bit bigger. Like, because I remember hearing about them a couple of years back.
Yeah, Sal's awesome. They're a great band. I just did a live stream for them.
It came
out awesome, and I think I'm pushing them to release the audio because it came out so well as just like a do something with it, because it's just a really fun recording that we did it live in a barn. It sounds great, and they should put that out. But yeah, they're great. I mean, and like so many, it's funny, like so many of the artists that I work with that seem to do well, like it's one of the best parts of the job. It's like we develop like a real close relationship and friendship with. So, you know, Sal from Rebuilder is over here all the time. He's always bringing these fucking insane hot sauces that he makes me try. And you know, like, and then Sam, the singer of Kali Masi, like we're going down to Austin next month. And I think he's going to come down with his girlfriend, you know, and meet us down there and hang out a little bit too. Yeah. It's just like, it's just way cooler. I mean, there's a commerce part of it too, but between us, you know, like I've done a lot of things where I don't have to depend on recording as a source of income. I do it because I really love it. That's not to say that I'm like the cheapest guy in town or anything, but you know, I bought a bunch of multifamily real estate here in Massachusetts. And just the moment Jesse walked into the bedroom with the pregnancy test and I looked at it and I said, plus means baby. And she said, yep. And I was like, whoo. And so the moment that happened, I was like, all right, well, I can't just rely on being a punk kid anymore. Like I'm about to have a kid. So I started investing, and I started investing, learning a lot. And I invested in some real estate in central Massachusetts. So that's been really good. And I started a bunch of stuff. I have a mentoring program. I started doing content. So I became the face of Pro Audio for reverb.com recently. Talking to Waves Audio about doing the same thing for them. And I'm CEO of a company called Maastr, and it's a really great sounding, mastering artificial intelligence platform. So like, typically you go to master engineer, whatever it is. Mastering's always been this thing, right? Where, you do your mix and it's like this nebulous dark art where like, all right, we have to get it mastered. And so you send it to the mastering guy and you just fucking hope it comes out how you want it to. And I've always found that process to be weird because the artist, like all your mix notes, like all your notes are always about the product that isn't actually going to be the product. Right. And I was like, how do we solve that problem? And so we did solve it. So we're starting to, so that exists now. It's awesome. It's out. Most of the features, basically all the features I want are in there. So we're going to start pushing that as well, and gaining users. But it's a monthly subscription service where you get unlimited cloud storage, unlimited collaboration tools, unlimited mastering with different, like three different mastering algorithms based if you're doing like singer-songwriter stuff, rock stuff, or maybe like more like hip-hop type stuff. And yeah, it sounds super good. We use it all the time. And so now I'm trying to educate and onboard engineers and artists to use this platform and sort of like take away the veil of like, why are we making notes? Why are we commenting on mixes when mixes aren't the product that people are going to hear, right? The reason is because mastering always takes a long time and getting mastering revisions takes forever. So it's like, what if we could fix that? What if there was a platform we uploaded shit to? Sounds great. And then let's make our notes on what's going to be the forward facing, like consumer fan facing product. That makes way more sense than making our notes. Yeah, making our notes on something that's not even going to be the thing. So I've been working on that every day. I have a great developer, Joe. What's up? He lives in New York, works for Reddit as well. And and it's our baby, dude. It's great. It already makes a bunch of money, and it's people love it. And just like our subscriber churn rate is only like 1.4%. Like once people actually get their like hooks into the platform, they stick around because it's like, it's very disruptive. And I'm sure I'm a mastering engineer, first of all, right? Right. But like, I'm sure every mastering engineer in the world right now is like, dude, fuck you. But yeah, it's really cool. So link that, check that out because it's, I like future shit and I like technology.
Nice. We'll link that for sure.
A very busy man. How are you finding kind of navigating your way through everything during the kind of pandemic as much as your approach had to change much? I mean, how's that working out for you?
Yeah, it's like, it's okay. We're lucky. We have a house, the studio's here. I've got like an acre of land. So when the weather's not shitty, you know, I can take my son out and we can kick the ball around and have a good time. But yeah, we take it pretty seriously. We're looking forward to the vaccine. But like today, when I'm done with this podcast, my wife runs her own business and she's got to go to her office and crush some stuff this weekend. So, you know, it's me and little man and we got to like sit inside all day, but it's freezing and we can't like, it's not like we can go to we used to go to like when it's cold in Boston, we'd go to these indoor playgrounds where, you know, you could run crazy. There's other kids there and like there's coffee for dad and it's cool, but like that's the last place you want to go right now. So it's just a bunch of kids like touching everything and sneezing on each other. So you can't do it. So the pandemic is tricky for everybody. I would say most people have it way worse than we do, but there's still things to navigate. I'm lucky, right? Like I run my company remotely. My company is like, I've got property management for the real estate. I got a studio here. I mix and master every day. So I'm kind of unaffected other than it's just sucky to not be able to interact with people as freely as you want to, just like the same problems everybody has. Like, yeah, it's just boring.
Yeah. Well, we're back in a national lockdown now, so.
Oh, yeah.
So yeah, well, our numbers have started to go back through the roof. So,
yeah.
Vaccines just started to be rolled out. So,
totally.
Fingers crossed. You know, 3-4 months down the line, hopefully, be in a better position. But
yeah, the estimates I've heard, it's going to be something like people are hoping by the end of the summer, things are back ish. My thing, I'm not putting a deadline on anything because, dude, like. I remember when this thing broke out and everyone was like, dude, can you believe it? We're going to be locked down for like 3 weeks. What the fuck? You know, like, yeah. You kids a year and a half or whatever. Like, or it's a year now, right? Almost. Yeah. So like by the time it's going to be done, it's going to be probably a year and a half. And if you look back, because I remember doing research like about, you know, pandemic, it was 1918, Spanish flu or whatever, ironically not from Spain. But I think that was about a year and a half at least too, for the whole thing to run its course. It's just like pandemic, you know, so
exactly.
It's going to take a while. Yep.
We've only got 2 weeks left of a Trump administration though. So
something
to look forward to.
Yeah, I know. That dude is literally he's going to go down in history as like one of the worst people ever.
Yeah.
Good job, buddy. I mean, I have some really strong opinions on like the reason I came out of retirement and started a new project, which is called Death of a Nation. It's because of the state of our country. It's a polarizing state. It's because of there's a lot of bullshit going on and all this fascist crap. And yeah. So I started a band. I called upon the singer of a band I had produced in the late 2000s, a band called Verse. So he fronts our band. And he's an amazing, amazingly thoughtful, intelligent lyricist in person. And to me, still has the best scream in all of hardcore. And so Andy and I and Quinn from Verse are doing this project. And we've been writing recently, particularly, I remember, you know, the other day when our fucking Capitol got invaded by dumbass thugs. I just couldn't. I was just beside myself, and I wrote two songs. I wrote two songs that night. The United States is fucked up right now. I hope very much that things chill out, but it is just ruthless. And we did a cross country trip over the summer. Like we were like, what do we do? What do we do with our time? So Andy, who I keep mentioning, owns a van rental company called Green Vans. He's got like 90 vans or something. So we took one of his vans. We took all the seats out of it. We flipped some of the seats around. We made like a mini living room in the back. I took my wife. I took Andy. I took my kid. And we drove from Boston to Seattle to surprise my grandmother for her 80th birthday. We were really careful. Oh, nice. So we got tested before we left. And then made sure we were safe and surprised grandma for her 80th. It was good. But I'll tell you what, dude. You know, when you forget. You know, you live in Boston, you know, I'm from Seattle. I grew up partly in California. Mm-hmm. And you fucking forget, like you start driving inland and
different attitude.
It was just crazy. We stopped in South Dakota at a place called Wild Drug, and I thought it'd be funny. It's this kitschy little tourist trap thing. It was not funny. I literally saw a 15-year-old girl walking with her dad with a shirt that said, "Fuck your feelings, Trump 2020. Bloody I was just hell. Like, like, yo, you are a little girl. What the fuck are you doing with that shirt? And also just like that mode of thinking is so horrible. Like how is anything going to work without some like inherent level of empathy for one another and for our situations? Yeah. And it's like, so can I say fuck your feelings? Like what's the point here? It's really weird.
Brighter times ahead though, hopefully.
Yeah, it would be hard to get worse. Fuck.
Yeah, that's true. Well, don't tempt the universe, right. Jay. Come on.
Dude, for real, we got like a global pandemic. We have the worst like death count in the entire world. Like we totally bumbled it. And our fucking capital's getting like invaded by like MAGA dumbasses. You know, it's like, what now?
Yeah. Okay, cool. We were going to do this top five of last year, weren't we, Chris? I don't know if Jay, you've had a think about it or brought anything.
I did. I probably already forgot, but I did. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
Should we dive into that?
Yeah, why not? And then we can maybe wrap this thing up.
Sure.
Yeah. I mean, this has been really cool. Nick, what do you reckon? Should we like all list our fives, or should we like do like one and go round and do it like that? What do you reckon would work better? Probably should have discussed this beforehand. Sorry about that, Jay.
It's okay. I'm trying to. There's a couple that I'm just got to make sure this. They aren't.
I found it really difficult, to be honest with you, and I don't think they're in a particular order either. So, yeah. Let's just do like on number fives and fours, and then threes and twos and ones.
Yeah, I'll try. It's gonna take
Okay, let's do it like that.
Gives us all some time to think in between.
Exactly. Yeah.
2019. Yeah, totally. We can do the fives. So should I start? Mine are not 100% not in order.
No. Mine neither. Yeah.
Okay, cool. So my number five, this is going to be one that no one's going to expect from me,
go on.
Is Music to be Murdered by Eminem.
Oh, right.
Yeah, it's really good. It's really good. There will be nothing else on my list like that, but it's really good. There'll be no flow poke. Through the tall grass, run your ass off. Yeah. Oh no, got your pants caught on the fence post, getting chased. Got them jack boys, thick as spot the floors like a lint roll. Let it wait till it's late, they will tiptoe through your living room window. Take a Nintendo and then skate, make it you feel like you got bent over. Run rape, little boy, you're never gonna get your rope chain. Get your shit stolen, your lips swollen. I became bitter as I got a little bit older. My hate was making me get cold. I began to get a chip shoulder, started to spit vogue on my zip code.
Okay, fair enough.
Shall I
yeah, you go right? next. You go next, yeah. Nick.
So my number five. Well, I guess on a side note to this, I've listened to a lot of Frank Turner's live album this year that he released. It was live. It was his live. It was like a storyteller album. It was live recorded in Newcastle, which obviously
cool.
I didn't go to. But my number five is NOFX version of Ballad of Me and My Friends. So
yeah,
NOFX
cool.
did a split with Frank Turner.
Yeah. It's really good.
Yeah, really good. I actually prefer the NOFX versions of Frank Turner songs rather than the Frank Turner NOFX
sure.
songs. So I went with Ballad of Me and My Friends. It's one of my favorite Frank Turner songs. I do love Thatcher Fuck the Kids as well. So that's my favorite.
Yeah, it was a lot of fun that. None of this is going anywhere. Yeah, so my first one is actually, it's Good Charlotte, and they put out a song called Last December, just before Christmas, but I've got a special reason that this is in my top five. Basically, not to bring the mood down, but like my father-in-law-to-be like passed away suddenly, like just before Christmas,
sure,
so it's been, yep. you know, which has obviously been quite a rough time, but... So this was like the day after or maybe 2 days after I just looked at my new releases and I saw a new Good Charlotte song and it said Last December and I was just like, I love Good Charlotte, but this sounds like it's going to be like one of their Christmas songs, which I enjoy normally, but I'm not in the mood for listening to it. But I gave it a spin anyway and straight away it's kind of like a poignant song. And I'd heard that the twins' dad had passed away last year and I was like, this sounds
sure.
like it was written about their dad and like the lyric, because it was kind of like, you know, a bittersweet song. And I was like, this is like exactly what I want to listen to right now. And like kind of gave me a little lift. But we were doing some stuff with their older brother, Josh, for our Christmas episode. And I messaged him telling him that. And like, he came back with a really nice email and he said, yeah, this song was written a week ago about our dad passing away last year. And I was just like, oh,
damn, dude.
That was,
wow. That's a really apt thing. Yeah. That's
yeah.
really good.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, so, totally.
It's actually randomly been a help like the last week. So that's my first one. I'll not ramble on all of mine in that sense.
No, totally. It's
as much as it has obviously some really deep sentiment, you couldn't get away with having a top five without a Good Charlotte song in your top five either, Chris.
That's true.
Being the fan that you are.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So this is a small artist from Montana. Everyone should check her out. She goes by Wilma Laverne Minor, and there's a song called Used To. To be fair, I'm biased, so I mixed this song, but
okay.
it was a collaboration. So Alan Day from 4 Year Strong produced this EP.
Oh, nice. Oh, yeah, we had him on our show. In fact, that's how his manager, who you share a manager totally. With him. That's obviously how
I do. I do share a manager with Alan. That's right. Yeah. So Alan produced this song and he hit me up and he said, I think you'd be a good fit to mix this. So the girl, she goes by Wilma Verminer. Her name's Kaylin. Kaylin flew out, mm-hmm. Came here, and Alan, Kaylin, and I mixed this EP. It's really good. Sweet. But yeah, so yeah, it's the EP is called Used To, and the song I really like off of it, I guess I'm going to go with Used To. All the songs are really good, but that came out this past year. It's awesome. Most days I just wish we never met. I used to think you were a stroke of genius. I used to.
So my number four, I've gone with, well, it could have been a few songs of this album, but it's from the new Anti-Flag album that was released earlier in the year.
Oh, yeah.
2020 Vision. But yeah, there's a few on there I could have picked from, but yeah, I guess it continued on from American Fall in terms of being a bit more upbeat and a bit poppier and
yeah, a bit more polished.
Yeah, you know, obviously really relevant protest songs at the moment, addressing all the fucking
definitely.
Shit and hate and racism that's going on in the world right now. So, yeah, I had to include a song from that record. Carry on, carry on, carry on. Tell me which side
are you on? Carry on, carry on, carry on. I've gone for a song by Slick Shoes, who put out an album for the first
Slick
time.
Slick Shoes!
Yeah, they put out an album for
shit.
The first time
I've
in years.
Slick Shoes in a long time. Damn, that like Old Tooth and Nail band?
Yeah.
No shit, wow.
Because they're, I don't know if they ever officially split up, but they've kind of been part-time for a few years and like been putting out the odd song here and there. But they did a full length that came out in September. And,
I'll check it out.
You know, it's very, it's them doing what they used to do. So, but there's some solid songs on it. And there's a really good track called 2008. So I'd recommend giving that one
a listen. Yeah, I'll check it out. That's awesome. Slick Shoes. Didn't see that one coming. All right, number threes, again, not in order. I'm going to go with Flowers of Light by Caspian off of the new Caspian record, which is On Circles. Caspian, they're from the North Shore of Boston. We did a UK tour with them. UK and Europe. We did a tour with them, like a three-week tour. Awesome dudes. I'm a sucker for post-rock. In general, especially instrumental post rock, and I'd always been a Caspian fan, like long before I knew them.
Yeah.
And then I remember being on that tour, being like, "You guys are the fucking real deal. They are a very, very good band." So, gotta throw Caspian in there for sure.
Nice. So my number three, staying on the Alan Day theme, I've gone with a 4 Year Strong track from the new record Brain Pain that released April time, I think it was.
No, I think it was February, almost a year ago now.
It was earlier than that. Yeah. Okay. Learn to Live a Lie off that record. I think it's my favourite song off the record. It's
cool.
Just really, really fun track, really well put together. Love it.
I've gone for a Newfound Glory song next. Their record got mixed reviews this year, but I thought it was really good. It's one of my favorite records by them. I went for the song Trophy because it's got a massive chorus on it.
Man, you're busting out all this pop punk that I need to listen to. I forgot to listen to all this. Slick Shoes and Newfound Glory. That's crazy.
Yeah, we all could right, be so... having this conversation in 1999 at this rate.
Yeah, you sure could. Yeah. You gotta know I'm gonna race and came up empty. Until I met you and now you're my trophy. What was it an objective by you? I feel like a winner when I'm standing by you. Not exactly pop punk, but a poppier. I'm going to do the From Exile record from the Menzingers.
Nice.
Their quarantine record. Yeah. And basically everything on there is awesome. But the way they reprised America, You're Freaking Me Out, is super creative and super good.
Yeah.
Really. When I first heard it, I like didn't even realize it was the same song. And then like I heard the melodies and the lyrics. I was like, oh my God, this is super clever. So that's my number two, right? Yeah. Yep.
Good choice.
Nice. Yeah, it's a good record. I've enjoyed that this year.
Yeah, me too.
Yeah.
My number two, so it wasn't actually released this year, last year, I should say. It was released in 2019, but I've listened to it a lot this year, and it's a bit of a sellout as well. Obviously, Machine Gun Kelly had his introduction into the kind of pop-punk world last year. The album itself I think it was well put together, didn't massively connect with me. But the song he did and the build up to that with a young British artist called Youngblood and Travis Barker called I Think I'm Okay. I've loved that track and I've played it all throughout the year. And I think he's done a great job with that record. I think he's had some good guidance from Mr. Barker and whoever else he worked with on that record.
Can I say that I still haven't heard Machine Gun Kelly.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I still haven't. I hear his name
old
every
and
fucking
new?
Day.
Yeah. Old and new stuff?
I haven't heard anything. I don't know. Who is this? I hear about this machine. I feel like grandpa right now, but I hear about this constantly. I'm just too busy listening to like fucking Russian Circles and old Fugazi records. Yeah. You know what I mean? Like,
well, I mean, I couldn't tell you any of Machine Gun Kelly's pre-
Sure.
pop punk, punk rock kind of music.
But
yeah, I think he's done a great job. And obviously this young lad, Youngblood, I don't know if you've heard of him. He's from Doncaster down the road from Newcastle a little bit, and he's making a lot of waves. And that
was on the Graham Norton show last night.
They're both making big waves, aren't they? Yeah. And he's got a Burt McCracken kind of vibe to him, especially on that song. It's got a very used feel to it as well, which I quite like. So. Hurt myself sometimes. Is that too scary for you? Watch me take a good thing and fuck it all up in one night. Catch me, I'm the one on the run away from the headlights. No sleep, I'm all week wasting time with people I don't like. I think
okay, I'll go with my next one, which I've gone for Machine Gun Kelly too. I mean, that record, do you know what? It didn't have as much staying power for me as I hoped, because I really loved it when I first listened to it, but because it's so poppy and it's just, you know, a bit lightweight, I think, once you spend some time with it. But it has some great pop songs, like the one he did with Halsey, Forget Me Too. That's the one I've gone for, because yeah, it's just a huge chorus.
That's awesome. Why don't I ever see you sober? You want me to forget you? Okay, forgive me too. You tell me you hate me, baby. Yeah, I bet you do. I'm keeping you waiting, but I won't wait on you. You want me to forget you? Okay, forgive me too. Hey, you. Tell me why. All right, number one with a bullet. I talked about this band earlier in the podcast, but I hate to talk about shit I did, but I just got to on this one. The record's coming out in 2021, but the single came out in 2020, and that's going to be The Stray by Kali Masi. Band rules. So I want everyone in the world to check out this band, because they're doing a UK European tour this spring, I believe, as long as it doesn't get canceled. Exactly. Scheduled to, we'll see. But yeah, so check out The Stray by Kali Masi and just check out that band in general. They're awesome.
Definitely. Cool.
So my number one is a song that you introduced me to, Chris, and a band you introduced me to. It's a song by The Lovebreakers.
This is my one as well. I'll say it straight.
So, song by The Lovebreakers. Feel free to chip in at any point. Chris.
Yeah, sure.
Song is called Family Man. The UK band from Birmingham. Very much kind of got a 70s, 80s kind of rock and roll kind of vibe, punk rock style, produced by Dave Warsop from the Beat Union.
Do you know Davey Warsop?
Another name.
Yeah, he's a producer out in, he's from Birmingham too, but he moved out to LA to work with Hurley, where he's done a lot of bands. Cool. And he used to have a band called Beat Union, who would like the same sort of sound, and like it's got his handprints all over at this one, but
this wasn't planned either.
It wasn't.
That's really funny.
It's like I recommend definitely when you get a moment, it's like Love Breakers, one word, and the song's called Family Man. Check it out.
Yeah.
It's just
I will for sure. Awesome,
nice old school vibes.
Yeah, it's got the horns, it's just really fun listen. I think it probably connects a bit more to us from an age perspective as well.
Sure.
Them as a band, they're probably more around our age, aren't they, Chris?
No, I think they're, I mean, the lyrical content seems appropriate to it, because we're I think around your age, Jay, maybe slightly younger, but pretty much the same age. But yeah, they look a lot younger, but I think the lyrical content and the sound of that song,
totally,
you know, is more appropriate to us. Flash my yard or to die, I won't be setting free. I'm a family man, nice to meet you, come and shake my hand.
Anything on the radar for 2020 that's worth chatting over quickly?
Do you mean 2021?
2021, God, yeah. So stuck.
I actually don't know who's putting out records in 2021. It's weird, right? Because like most of 2020, I mean, so I own this recording studio and I can tell you, I've mixed and mastered a bunch of stuff, been working on my other projects, but you know, we're not tracking shit comparatively. Who wants to be in a little recording studio, right? Like just breathing all over each other.
So
the tracking bookings are way down. It'll be really interesting to see. But I mean, you know, once the pandemic's over, I really think that live music's going to completely explode. Like people are just totally starving. They're going to go out every night, you know?
Yeah.
We talked about it with quite a few of our guests, like the back end of last year, about just the appetite being kind of bigger than ever, and just to get out and to...
Oh my God, yeah.
Yeah, to get out and watch some live music, in what format that is, who knows?
Like, I know. You know.
I mean, we've spoken to some people who are like, you know, cool with the whole socially distanced gigs where you have your areas and stuff. Whereas we've spoken to Alan Day, for instance, who was like, I don't want to do it if it's not fucking kids in the pit and like, you know, want to go full hog. So we'll see what.
That's cool. I bought my Christmas tree from Alan.
Oh, did you?
Yeah. We drove out to his farm and we let my son pick out a Christmas tree from Alan. It was pretty awesome.
His farm sounds really cool from what you told us about it.
It's really cool. It's really pretty. I kind of agree with him. Yeah, I don't know, man. Like I think, you know, man, it really makes you appreciate what we took for granted. Cause, you know, be like, hey, you going to the show tonight? You know, and you'd be like, I don't know, you know. Now I'd be like, yes, of course. Of course I'm going to the show. What am I going to sit in my house?
Yeah, definitely.
Had enough of that.
Yeah, totally.
I've definitely been guilty of that, of just kind of shunning shows just because I've had a busy day at work and I don't want to spend the money or whatever. But, you know, I think, like you say, the appetite will hopefully be might be hard to get tickets for shows at some point, yeah. Like the ones you actually want to go to.
Oh, are you kidding? Yeah. It's going to be crazy. People are going to lose their minds. Once it's like actually finally safe, I think we'll see like a resurgence, like a, it's going to be like the swinging 20s around here again, you know? People are just going to be fucking wiling out, just going for it, totally.
Okay, cool. We could probably wrap this up now, I think.
Sure thing.
That's cool with you guys.
Yeah,
Jay, thanks so much for giving us your time on your Saturday morning. Massively appreciate it.
My pleasure. It's really fun. I think it's really funny that I tried to do this podcast yesterday on accident.
Yeah, I forgot to mention that.
Yeah, and then I woke up this morning when I emailed you like, hey, I'm going to be a minute behind. It's because I woke up, and so I was supposed to do this 10 a.m. my time. I woke up and I looked at my phone. It was 9:59.
I was
like, but you know what was good? Is I set all this shit up yesterday. So I was like, well.
So the mistake yesterday served you well. Nice.
It did, for sure. For sure.
Good stuff. Well, thanks for joining us, man. And you have a good weekend with the little one.
Yeah. Thanks, guys. All right. This was fun.
Thank you for listening. If you liked what you heard, we'd love it if you could subscribe to us wherever you get your podcasts, whether that's iTunes or Spotify or Stitcher or anywhere like that. Also, check us out on social media. If you just search for Wasting Time Podcast on Instagram or Twitter or Facebook, give us a like or a follow on any of those. And also, we love hearing from listeners as well. So feel free anytime to drop us an email at thewastingtimepodcast@gmail.com, or obviously you can message us on social media as well. But we'll catch you next time. For you to arrive.